continue to.
Kathy Lynch could keep on surprising at the Commonwealth Games. This cyclist from Motueka certainly knows international competition. She's already represented New Zealand at whitewater canoeing. She's New Zealand mountain bike champion and a more than competent ski racer. And Doug Armstrong found she's had tremendous support along the way. There's always a couple of friends around as she trains on the roads of Golden Bay.
Lynch was a virtual unknown in road cycling until this year. Now she's in the Games team. Kathy got talked into going to Auckland for the national champs just to make up the numbers for Nelson Marlborough. It's a real rags to riches story.
I started, like a lot of road cyclists, in triathlon, and I continue my road cycling because it was of benefit to me in my kayaking. It was another form of fitness, developing lungs and heart. And then I realised I was doing quite well on a bike, and I got talked into a few races, and a few races
too. Talked into by whom?
Oh, by Bruce Vanson, the guy we were out training with last night, and a few others to go to races. And I started going to races, and I thought, gee, I'm doing all right. So I kept going and kept going. And then when I found I was getting better, it became an even more challenging to get even better than I was doing, and it's just stemmed from there. Even now I feel I'm getting a lot more stronger in the past month, and I'm riding a lot better than I ridden even, what, a month ago.
You know, I said that you've only, kind of raced this way for less than a year, but you knew what a bike was, didn't you? Because you have been involved with bikes for many years.
Oh, yes, certainly. There's no way anyone could just get on a bike and ride to a standard like that within 1 year. I've always ridden a bike all my life. I started off last summer riding mountain bikes, and I rode 4 races last year for the National Mountain Bike Series, and I really enjoyed that. But that gave me a background of fitness and stamina and strength, and it was just a matter of getting on the road bike and developing a few more aspects of the sport.
Kathy, according to the experts, has amazing potential. She's very strong, yet so inexperienced. How she's got where she has without even a coach is one of the wonders of the cycling world.
I think I'm riding with a lot of experienced people, and I've learned from them. Even though I don't have one specific coach, I am continually learning off other riders the whole time. Lots of them are really helpful. If I'm doing something wrong, they tell me about it. It's just certain aspects of my training I learn through trial and error, but I find that's quite enjoyable too, because it's part of the challenge of the sport. Of course, now I'm in the Commonwealth Games team. I do have the national coach on hand, and he will no doubt be sending me a training program, but reaching the standard I have without a coach, I think any person can do so.
Now tell me, Kathy, how do you know if you're doing things the right way?
Who said there is a right way? As long as you keep an open mind and you're always prepared to learn, you soon know if you're doing things the wrong way.
Kathy works in Motueka as a wages clerk for the big fisheries firm Tallies.
During the winter road season, I found it exceptionally difficult to train because it was dark at 6 o'clock at night. I'm not really a morning person. I wasn't prepared to get up and do hours in the morning, and therefore I was having what they call an extended lunchtime, and quite often I'd be out on my bike between 12 and 2 doing some training work and stuff like that. I really held them to ransom, I guess, because if they didn't like it, they had one alternative, and that was to fire me. And although they never fired me for doing so, I got a hard time most days through coming back late from training rides. But now that I have achieved a game selection, well, I can float off any time of the day to go for a training ride, and it's not so bad anymore.
Who's you obviously then have set your own training pattern?
Yes, oh yes, definitely. I try to do so many kilometres a week, and 1 week maybe just doing speed work, another week doing distance work, because I have a couple of books that had training programs in them, and I have experimented lots.
You're telling me you haven't got a coach and you learn out of books, is that right?
Yes.
Oh, you are quite unique. The roads around Motorwaga seem perfect for your training.
Oh, they are. They're very quiet. They're very picturesque. Got very good surfaces on them. We've got lots of hills. Everywhere you go from Mops, you've got a hill ride, and I believe hills are the answer to any road cycling success. You can train on hills and get really fast and fit in a short period of time, whereas training on the flat, you can't get very fit for the hills. Whereas training on the hills, you get fit for the flat.
You're about the same age as Madonna Harris and Sue Matthews. Is that for the type of racing that you're doing? Is that a kind of an ideal age? I'm not going to tell people what it is. But is it about the right sort of age?
Oh, I don't really know what the right age would be, but I feel as a woman gets a little bit older, they develop a lot more endurance. That's not to say that younger women don't also have endurance, but I do feel it takes several years to develop it.
This has all come on you pretty quick. I mean, it's how have you handled it? Is it just, has it been easy?
No, it's awful, you guys turning up. I don't like this part of it at all.
Well, yes, you must.
I just want to ride my bike.
You must have some hopes and aspirations, though, for over the next few months. What would you like to do? What's your final hope for what happens in Auckland?
Well, I wouldn't say Auckland's going to be the end of all everything. It's just one peg in one goal in a series.
Would you like to ride well, obviously?
Oh, of course, yes, but I can't really set my sights and my hope and put my whole life into just riding well in one race. Because as any road cyclist will tell you, that doesn't always happen, but if you do well, if you race well, it's a bonus. But it's certainly not the end all.
Well, I think, Kathy, you've surprised a lot of people already, and that you're going to surprise a few people in January, February in Auckland.
Well, I hope it's a good surprise then.
And we're sure that it will be a good surprise. There's plenty of Christmas spirit around right now, and yet, believe it or not, there's some game spirit. The organisers have got flags flying all over Auckland. The tickets for many events are even sold out. It's all about participation. But let's face it, everyone wants to win, and this is all about motivation.
Let's go.
Donald Allison put that together for Mobile Sport.
The New Zealand swimming, diving and synchronised swimming championships, which were completed here at the West Auckland Swim Centre last weekend, were judged a pretty good success. That's even though the facility was criticised in some quarters for being a fire risk. But in fact, in terms of the water conditions in the pool and in the diving pool, it's very good indeed. And we're looking, New Zealand, to have a very strong team at the Commonwealth Games in water sports, particularly so in swimming.
Well, you can see him winding up and he's starting to kick. He's got an unusual kick in which one foot comes right up out of the water each time just after his breath. I think it's just a balancing mechanism, but there he is coming into the final. An excellent swim, probably the best distance swimmer we've seen in New Zealand for a number of years.
He becomes the first junior swimmer in New Zealand to go under 16 minutes. 14 years of age, Danyon Loader from Zenith and Otago. Well, Lockhart, he held it onto those blocks to save himself from falling. Now, away they go, and Lockhart came up in the lead after that wobble on the starting blocks. What did you think
of
it?
Well, that was a great start. He was last to go off, but in fact, he went deep and came up ahead. But watch, Forbes is right on him.
So it's the Roskill cap of Lockhart nearest to us, and then Grant Forbes. Crossing lane six, Mike Bevelin going pretty well too. That's the three. Lockhart seems to have the lead. Lockhart touches, he got there. Forbes second. I think Bevelin might have got through in third place. Yes, he did. It was 4, 5 and 6. But Richard Lockhart has won it. His time is 29.97, just outside the New Zealand record. Out they came. The start is so very important. And Simcic up in the shoulder length clear of Musson after the start.
You can see those few butterfly kicks upside down. They're restricted to 10 metres now. And Simcic is up and out flying.
Anna Simcic, she won the 100, she won the 200. She seems to be leaving Musson behind, so much so that the second place getter could be Louise Soper or Sarah Strawbridge.
Well, this is important for Simcic. She's got to learn to do these first laps very fast. She had difficulty in the past.
Simcic touches to win. Very fine swim by her, 30.89.
Well, there was really no question about it. It was Simcic's race right from the start. Very convincing start, and she started her first 4 or 5 strokes very, very solidly, and so really there was no question about the race.
They weren't held for very long in the 100 meter freestyle final, and they're up and grabbing at the water already, and a flying start to lane 7, Mark Weldon. We're looking down the lane at Nicholas Sanders, but look at Weldon over in lane 7.
Well, Weldon is pulling one off. Andy Hamilton tried this last year. Whether he's got it for the second length, we'll have to wait and see.
Okay, they go to the wall. A great swim by Craig Jones as well. And Jones had the lead from Weldon. It's lane 2 and lane 7. Let's look for the white caps in the center. Where's Sanders? He doesn't seem to be there. Steele is coming through the middle now. But down in front of us is Craig Jones. Steele getting the big arms winding up. And Weldon over the far side holding them off. It's the big 100 meter freestyle, and Steele has got to the front from Weldon. Great swim by Weldon, but Steele's got it. 51.86 for John Steele. Second place has gone to Mark Weldon, a brave swim by him. And third, Byron Reed came through from nowhere, but they couldn't beat John Steele.
Well, here you can see it's 9/10 leg drive with a very quick arm stroke, and here's Michaela Ross making her play.
Michaela Ross coming up to the white cap of Danielle Bates and forging ahead with each stroke. So we've got the winner of the 50 meter and the white cap Bates, and Michaela Ross in the red cap who won the 200. Who's going to win the 100? Michaela Ross getting to the lead, and she goes to touch. Anderson faded away. Bates was second. Fiona Ross was third, and Anderson was fourth. But it's a double gold for Michaela Ross, the 16-year-old from Whanganui, who beats Danielle Bates, 1:15.02. And that's underneath the nomination time for the Commonwealth Games. So Michaela Ross underscores her inclusion in the New Zealand team. Getting across there to have a word with her sister.
Watch for the power of Simcic, because here's where she puts her head down and starts to go for it.
Shelley Rowland up towards the top in the yellow cap from Hawke's Bay going well. But it's half a body length lead to Anna Simcic with 20 metres to swim. Simcic from Burke, Radal is third. Simcic's done it again. That's 4 goals for Anna Simcic. Second place, Michelle Burke. Third place, Monique Radal. And out of the water from the 50-meter backstroke event straight back in for the next race to win the 100 metres butterfly. She's amazing. Do you have personal goals that you've got in your mind for each of the events that you will swim in again?
Yeah, I'm just really going for PBs to do my best there, and if I do PBs, I should be out amongst the medals, hopefully.
Are you a person that has mental visions of winning and standing on the dais?
Yeah, I do a lot of visualisation, and I think that helps too. I think that's got me where I am.
What will you be doing between now and the first day that you swim in the game?
I'll be, in 2 weeks I'm off to Colorado to do high altitude training with a small team, and then I'm back to Auckland on the 17th and then straight into it.
Now there's a small event called Christmas that most New Zealanders enjoy very vigorously. How about yourself? What happens to training?
Well, I'm leaving on Christmas Day, Eve, at 9 o'clock that night, so I'll have that day at home. I guess I'll have that day off.
We did a great job in 84 and 86, really consolidating the swimmers. We had a great following in 1986, then again with our success in the 88 Olympics, and then the Commonwealth Games in Auckland. I mean, what better excuse to have a great team, no matter what sport it is.
Anthony, on a lighter note, what about the whiskers? They always talk about shaving down in swimming. What's the story on the whiskers? When are they coming up?
Well, these are a few days' growth, rather pitiful, I must say. About another...
Not a full growth, I might say.
Not very even at all. This is the best I've ever done, though. So I'm quite proud of that. This will come off around about the 24th or 25th of January. Been going about a week now.
Does that sort of create a feeling of optimism, too, that you're clean, shaven, down and ready?
That's exactly what it is. When you shave down, you feel clean, you feel good, you look good, you feel good, and you can perform. You know, it's like swimming with a baggy swimsuit on. When you take them off and swim with a nice, tight, small, clean one, obviously you're going to swim faster, it feels cleaner. Same with a shave, not only with the face, but the whole body as well.
Okay, Anthony, what are your personal goals for the Commonwealth Games?
My personal goal is to do the job on the day. That's all I'll say right now. You'll have to wait and watch, and I promise you it will be good.
So with swimmers like Anthony Moss, Paul Kingsman, and Anna Simcic in such good form at the National Championships, New Zealand is sure to have a strong squad for the Commonwealth Games. But Lincoln Hurring, is it a squad that's going to satisfy the New Zealanders' thirst for medals? Because that's what we all like to see at their games.
Well, I'm sure there's going to be a barrow full of medals. In fact, it's going to be the most successful team we've ever had.
Why do you say that? What's been the reason for the big improvement?
Well, first of all, I think I'd like to praise New Zealand swim coaches. They've produced a great bunch of swimmers. But in fact, it's almost as if New Zealand has reached a critical mass. Below the level of the stars that we have, that we expect the gold medals from, there's a great bunch of very, very promising younger swimmers coming along, and we're going to have a full contingent at the Games.
Okay, we look forward to that. That's the prospects for the swimming team. Now let's talk about diving.
Now this is Nikki Cooney in the last round, the last diver in round five, a forward 1.5 somersaults.